We left things in the historic districts the way they are now. Design review by commission in other design overlay districts, which is Broadway, the Rondo.
We're in 3D now, right?
We're down 3D. Second paragraph of 3D would be advisory to the planning board where site plan approval or issuance of a special permit is required, or to the code enforcement officer where only a building permit is required.
Am I right in assuming that's the way it is for Heritage Commission now? That it's advisory in this similar way for most of what Heritage does?
No. In the Broadway Design District, you know, they make the decision.
Got it. Okay.
In other parts of the Heritage area,
it's advisory.
Advisory.
Got it.
But everything.
That's what we're trying to remove that.
Yeah, trying to simplify that would be a joy to everyone.
But anything that's regulatory held by one of the other commissions is going to be regulatory authority.
Except we're not going to have a Broadway overlay design, that Broadway overlay design standards are going to be, are they still going to be in effect or they're going to be?
What we're proposing is one more common design standards which would apply in all of the three different design districts.
Right, but then, yeah.
But where that happens to include landmark districts, you know, it's the same process now. It's the commission would be the authority elsewhere in those three districts they'd recommend to the planning board.
Has there been any thought given to trying to regularize the actual district geographical layout so that what Heritage has been doing uptown and what Historics has been doing uptown actually applies in equally? I mean, I of course, since I've done more Historics, I'm thinking of expanding the historic districts. You know, we have, what, 4 or 5? And spots of designated buildings scattered throughout the city. And it seems to me that Hayes has been dealing with a much broader geographic area all this time. And I don't know if in trying to regularize the function of this, has any thought been given to trying to make the lines make a little more sense?
Well, you got lines drawn by very, you know, you've got the lines that your commission is drawing, you've got one that the State Historic District has drawn, you've got the lines drawn.
I'll tell you then, but actually the city is who's drawn all those lines. Before it goes to SHPO, the city sends it on to SHPO, who generally approves. So it is a city function.
That's one character. The Heritage area is the state drew that line.
Oh, okay.
Right.
The local,
a totally different genesis.
The local waterfront revitalization plan, the coastal boundary is also a different state function.
Okay. So that's a different rule imposed by the Department of State.
Yeah, it's a different, it's got different meaning and different ground rules, and what we try to include those functions in here, that the third of which is the advice and management of the Kingston Heritage Area, which is really what, you know, where the Heritage Area Commission's reason for being
original
came from, yeah. And they can, and it's a somewhat vaguer assignment because there aren't a lot of specific standards to follow. It's more general advice, but they would continue to perform that function, as they would continue to be the ones to make recommendations of whether or not an action in the coastal zone is consistent with the city's local waterfront revitalization.
Got it, okay. So that will be a learning curve from the folks on my commission that Hayes, yeah. folks on Hayes's commission have already got.
I mean, it is.
And vice versa.
Is yeah. there general agreement with that approach? I mean, we've got a lot of articulation as the way to draft it out, and there's always the way the city's code has been produced. You've got to make sure you touch base on other sections of the code where these things have been referenced and are going to be deleted or moved or whatever. But
well, eventually you're going to have three distinct urban cores too, right? Midtown urban core, right?
Well, we got the design.
Is it going to be a whole new, basically a whole new zoning area? It's going to incorporate other zoning district plan. Mm-hmm. So
for the moment,
like the language from those, how the commission's affected other zoning areas as they're called now, you've got to link that into the language into the urban core now.
Well, we've got the design guidelines that are going to apply to those three urban cores. And
right.
But I mean, all that needs to be.
Yeah, there's a lot of.
Transferred over, kind of.
A lot of cross referencing.
Right, I think that's in the first paragraph of 3B, the cross referencing the urban core
design standards. Yes,
I mean, that's going to be. So that's going to, that will take place.
That's a. Really careful writing that.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then we just put
out a coordinated review that Dan brought up is going to be a huge help in making that work. Mm-hmm. The getting us into the seeker process earlier that way is something that I know that my commission has been hoping for a very long time.
Right. Okay. Good.
Yeah, we'll just have.
I have a question. Can you explain? So you've got design standards, and so the design standards are going to be the same for all the areas. Can you explain what that means? And also, there's the Midtown, now it's, as I understand it, it's a Midtown design overlay. And then the proposal is to instead make what's going to be termed as a form-based code overlay. Are the design, are you saying the design standards are going to be the same every block and also every neighborhood? So it'll be just one set of design standards that's going to be for all of those areas? Is that what you're saying?
We recommended one base set of design standards, which is somewhat less rigid and specific than some of the existing design standards, which would apply to Broadway, around that, and then in Uptown they would also incorporate the stockade district standards, which are in both the zoning law and the chapter 264.
So there'll be less standards than there are now for Rondo. Less rigid standards.
The standard at the moment, there are no standards which apply to Broadway in Rondo and Rondo at all, other than being what's in the historic district.
Right, the historic districts all have to live up to the federal standards. That
so they'll still have to live up to those federal
yes.
standards?
Yes.
But, within the historic district, the heritage area is a broader spot.
Okay, so this would be the, you're talking, referring to what the heritage area encompasses, you're referring to now.
Yes.
Oh. What do you mean by
when you say that there should be a less rigid design standards that would be for the Rondo area, the Midtown area, and the Stockade area, and then the Stockade area would have an additional standard. Right. When you
what you just described is not the heritage area.
So, this would be design standards for Midtown, Downtown, and Uptown would be a single set of design standards.
No.
And then additionally, there'd be a heritage area?
With supplementary for the Stockade area. And they've been rewritten, and we should go back and spend another subject of another meeting on them. We've written them so the design standards presently for those three areas, particularly the Broadway, it's not
Like the Broadway design overlay.
And there's another, there's a, which we're not going to tinker with, is the design, the roundabout, what's it called? The roundabout overlay design district is essentially the strip between Beale Street and the creek. But it's different because it has various provisions which relate to the waterfront. But they're very similar, those three districts, but somewhat different. We propose making them the same rather than trying to wrestle with the minor differences. And a little bit more general, and also to include an exclamation as to why these design details are relevant and important, rather than what we believe was that the existing districts are somewhat overly detailed. And
is that the difference between guidelines and standards? So it'd be more guideline, less standard?
Well, there's still standards, but they're just not quite as rigid standards.
Aren't standards by definition rigid?
It depends on what level of detail you get. You get down to the width of each mountain in the window should be is a standard. That's a lot more rigid than saying that windows should have muntins which are consistent with the period of the window at the time or something.
That's very open to interpretation, I imagine. But okay, so what I guess I'm not really understanding is the Midtown overlay, for example, that's going to be going. But you did say there's going to be a form-based overlay instead.
I didn't say the Midtown overlay was going. The Midtown design overlay district would be replaced by this new set of design standards.
That would be for there and for the Rondout area and uptown.
Correct.
So, and it would be the same standards for all three areas.
No.
No?
The standards are tailor-made to the area.
But the
Stockade District standards are different. They're, Lower Broadway and Midtown Broadway are not significantly different in terms of the kind of standards you require. We should go over to the next meeting.
I think it would probably be helpful to have a map and see what we're talking about on that.
Because the urban core doesn't go all the way down to Rondout.
No.
That's what...
Which? No.
The urban core.
No, well, we refer to them without particularly giving them precise boundaries, but we refer to the, the downtown core, the midtown core, and the uptown core.
They're not going to have exact boundaries?
They've been, for planning purposes at this point, the districts will have specific boundaries.
The planning of the zoning, and eventually they will before it goes to law, is that what you're saying? Or they will never have boundaries?
We've talked about the cores in terms of the focus of attention. They're not specific districts. It's just a way of identifying the three areas of concern. There will be specific districts around the Midtown form-based overlay district. There will be a specific district with a specific boundary within that Midtown core.
So I think, I don't want to continue in that direction and get finished this, but if you called Sue, you could probably go over all that with her, and if you want to bring it up next meeting, we can work it out.
All right, we'll do that.
Okay, before we move on, I just had a thought on the appeals process. What if we made the mayor the option if he wanted to review it or not? And if he doesn't want to overrule it, he could just amend an Article 78. I mean, if it's something, I just hate to see people having to hire legal counsel to try and, go through the system to get an appeal, It's just not. He appoints most of the board members anyway, Probably save him from making phone calls. If he just.
I think the point of
go into the Article 78, though, is to remove the political interjectory to process, and that...
Politics.
Get the issue out.
We hang it everywhere.
I know.
Yeah, but putting corporate counsel's office in a position, we're going to have to defend it as well for 7 years, that we should be able to stop before they get to that point by saying, there's no merit here, okay? Without an appeals process, there's no vehicle for corporate counsel's office to step in and advise either the mayor or the common council that it's not in the interest of the city to, you know, to support a decision that's arbitrary and capricious before hurtling towards an Article 78.
What if the appeal did go to the zoning board or the planning board instead of the common council? It's less political. I mean, we are talking about things that are a little bit different, like possibly, like, I mean, there are conversations about colors of paint and things, which I'm not saying that that's not important, but going to court over that does seem...
You get into expertise. I mean, I'm the zoning board of appeals. I do not have expertise in these areas as Hayes would have. Common council isn't either, by the way, unless they're an architect or something in the common council. So
it doesn't always work out either.
You know, I mean,
but we regularly have applications in front of Hisaurus where Hisaurus is denying permission for something that is clearly permitted in all respects under the code. And under those circumstances, I can't defend it in Article 78.
For example, replacing...
A sign that is
blacktop,
clearly...
Blacktop on a sign.
That is clearly permissible under the code.
Exactly.
Clearly falls within the restrictions of the code, but HLPC, because they decide that it is not historically accurate, denies permission. Okay, I can't take that to an Article 78 and defend it.
So then the Article 78 process is pretty straightforward and quick, right?
Well, it's an Article 78 process is never straightforward.
But if the city chooses to cave, then the applicant wins.
What's the history been recently? How many times has somebody taken an Article 78 against one of your decisions?
What happens is that applicants ignore the decisions that are rendered by HLPC and go and do the work anyway, and it basically guts the power of the HLPC.
And that just happened with the last couple months, too. Yeah.
Basically, you are discouraging people from filing the applications because they believe that...
Oh, I agree. That's been a problem. I don't disagree. I just... You know, having one person, the mayor, or nine people in common council have the authority to overrule a commission that's set up for a very specific reason to be a commission, not just advisory. It just opens up a can of worms that I would have to think through. I mean, of all the options, I might be most comfortable with ZBA or planning board being an appeal process to it, but not the common council, not the mayor alone.
Well, the planning board might be the most logical one. The way it's set up now, the non-district design reviews would be made by the planning board. So they have familiarity with it. And if they could function as a planning board, as a appeal board for decisions from the historical.
Well,
I think what Jim said earlier too, another option could be to set up a separate board that has members from each of the different commissions. So there might be a ZBA rep, there might be a heritage rep, there could be a landmarks rep, there could be a planning board rep. And maybe that's
then corporation
something
council can sit in and say, hey, this is how I feel
about it.
And they only meet once a year.
You told me.
But I don't think it should be monthly.
As needed.
As needed?
Yes.
But when I asked the question before, I said that these come up quite a bit.
In the 20 years I've served, we have not had...
We haven't had an Article 78, but every month we have people who leave, who are either going to ignore the decisions that were made, or, you know, are seriously...
So these number of people now will have an appeal process.
There is no appeal process.
No, there's no guarantee they'll avail themselves.
If there's a board put in specifically for appeal, they're going to be kind of busy. They're not going to be once a year. People are...
Can they just set up another board with that?
To me, it makes sense to have...
Another appeal?
Yeah, that's what they're talking about setting up.
People with the expertise, point people who have expertise.
Chairman Emeritus should...
Are there any penalties now for ignoring the decision?
In my day, if they didn't like the decision, they called the mayor. And either Sue or I would go in the office and, you know, depending upon who it was mentioning, no names, would holler and scream and, you know.
But are there any penalties now for ignoring the decision?
The penalties for ignoring the decision is if my office decides to prosecute them in city court for violating the code, it's up to a judge whether or not a penalty will be imposed, and the judge has a wide range of remedies. A judge can say, I don't care. A judge can say, you have to take it down and comply with, you know, with historics, or a judge can say, you can leave the work up and I'm gonna fine you. But that leads to a court proceeding. The advantage of what Jim had said in terms of the appeal going to the mayor is that as the chief executive, he can, you know, determine whether it's in the city's best interest to, you know, adhere to this decision and go to litigation, or whether or not, as the executive, he's going to make a decision that we can't support this.
But that could be if they like that developer and they want to cater to them. And developers are not going to come as readily. Really good developers who are going to make the city better, they want design standards that are specific, that are not going to always be flouted. They want to know that they are signing up for something that has a certain standards. And if it's like we've got all these systems for going around that, going to the mayor, saying, oh, but I'm a big developer, and the mayor may be somebody who's catering to big developers like CVS or Dunkin' Donuts, and they're going to be like, let them do it, it's going to be okay. And if we have guidelines versus standards, the bigger it is, that's also a problem.
Well, but the bigger projects have to go to the planning board and have to get planning board approval. When they don't get planning board approval, they have to go to Article 78. We're really talking about the smaller issues that come in front of, you know, these boards related to things like signs and blacktop and colors of paint and issues of that.
Screening.
What's that?
Screening.
Things like that, yeah. You know, we're not talking about developers and site plan approval and secret issues. Those all go through the planning board. Planning board decisions go to an office.
But in the historic districts, it's much more than just signage often, isn't it? Can it be taking off your porch or adding a historic detail or removing dormers or putting up plastic signs?
Right. And we have had these battles for decades.
And if it's somebody who's, you know, they just bought, you know, they're buying that thing, it's another way for people. I know that a lot of people feel like, well, you're told you can get a variance. But that's really what people think of as, oh, you can get a variance, because whoever's giving the variance is, this cousin isn't going to have a B&B down the block. They're going to give you a variance unless their cousin wants to do a B&B down the block.
Can I make a suggestion?
Can we move on?
Can I make a suggestion? I like Sue's concept of like a combination of individual members.
You're really buying now. Come on.
Is that yours?
Yeah.
Okay.
It was.
Bringing people in from different boards with one little curveball, depending on the issue, maybe a zoning board member, zoning board may have some expertise in a particular issue that's being appealed, as opposed to just a permanent member of that appeal commission. Have representatives from the various boards, but kind of floaters, and they can discuss, well, I've got that expertise, well, can you serve on that commission for this particular decision? Just a suggestion.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So the board decides what number they want to send?
Right, based on particular expertise. I don't have any expertise in paint colors, but someone on the zoning board may have some expertise on that.
Goodbye, me. Goodbye, you.
Yeah, we figure it out.
Figure it out.
I think a board calling experts when it needs expertise is much better than catering a board so that there's experts on it, because that could go either way. And it's obvious, I mean, it doesn't matter what you do, it will always be somebody who thinks the reason you're doing it is so that the answer comes out the way they want it. So I think a board that's set up to do, you know, to hear an appeal has the ability to, you know, have other opinions brought in as well. Something that needs to be changed to cater.
So you're saying as a board should just be established and whoever's on it stays on it.
Yeah, exactly. If they don't have the ability,
then they can call.
Yeah.
They what?
They could ask for someone to come in and provide that expertise.
Is there a problem in board members reviewing their own decisions?
Of course.
Yeah, I just feel the need to point this out. You've got a real sort of logical problem of getting two bites, certain members getting two bites of a decision. And much as I understand the attraction of trying to gather a brain trust across commissions, every time they go to this appeal board, someone is like logically going to have to get knocked out because they're the ones who were part of the decision below.
They recuse themselves.
Okay, good discussion.
So I guess I'll have to be
going to the yard member.
Could we send it to another city's board? Send it to a city, whether it's the ZBA, and they have the ability to hire an expert to provide them advice.
So do we have any clear direction for Dan or not?
Not really. We've got a lot of homework to do.
Yeah, but there's no sense writing up a separate board and commission if the general consensus is to go keep the Article 78. So I think you need to establish the consensus around the table that we keep the Article 78, or is the consensus to have a separate board? No sense giving you a lot of extra work.
Yeah, I agree with that. We ought to make that decision. Exactly which board, if the decision is an appeals board, we can hassle about how and why.
But that's not the consensus.
But it's an either or, which, if you want to leave it the way it is, or Article 78, that's fine with me. It's your decision.
That's what I would say.
So we have one leaving it. I'm in favor of changing it.
Dan's point was well taken, that if a board or a commission makes a decision that is something that they are they cannot defend in court, and, you know, it's to me that makes sense. If it's a simple issue, you know, if it is a paint color or if it's a gate, you know, or a sign, you know, design thing, and it meets with the code, then I, you know, making an individual go to an Article 78 is difficult.
So I don't think what he was saying was difficult, though. I think he was saying is he can't defend us in that decision.
Right.
We lose is what the answer was.
Yeah, and we pay the council fees.
And we pay the council fees, so it's going to cost
the other side. Right.
So that's that matter when you said that.
But Dan, can't that happen on any of the boards? Couldn't the zoning board, you're right, you confer with us at every meeting. Couldn't the zoning board say, no, we're approving that? And
you don't have the same types of decisions being made by the zoning board of appeals and the planning board with regard to you know, smaller, less significant issues that are clearly covered by the provisions of the code. The problems that we have in terms of defending on Article 78 is when the code specifically says that an individual can do something and, you know, historics refuses to grant permission. Okay, with the planning board has an entire site plan review, has an entire CEQA review, and, you know, they, you know, it's a completely different process. Here we are really talking about things like signs, we're talking about things like paint, we're talking about like the facades of, you know, the facade of a building, you know, whether or not somebody can move a column, things like that, where if the building department, following the state building code, says this is completely permissible, okay, and historic says, no, you can't do it. It's almost impossible for me to go to a judge and convince a judge that the individual shouldn't be allowed to do what the state building code says they can.
Okay.
And the same assembly and the other, you know, I mean, generally what happens if you know, somebody challenges a decision of that sort, and I mean, whether you're talking about a small claims action, whether you're talking about, you know, a civil action, my office goes to the Common Council, okay, and explains the situation and said, this is a case we can't defend, we have to settle this. Okay, and that's basically what you're talking about. You're talking about an equivalent process where we can go to either the Common Council or the Chief Executive and say, this is indefensible. Okay, we can't go to court. If we go to court, it's gonna cost the city a significant amount of money and we're gonna lose. You know, so.
And that's, we need a vehicle to get it to you.
Exactly. Yeah. There has to be a board that can make the decision so that there is a decision that's not based on opinion. Or
right. So that's where you've got to craft something that can create a vehicle to get it.
Actually, the sounder way to do that is just to make sure that what Historics does is grounded in things like the requirements of the Interior Department.
Which is why we're getting pretty far. We're getting, you know, pretty. Cart from a horse here, okay?
Yeah.
We don't even know what the combined language is going to look like. We don't know what the powers of the commission are going to be. We don't know how narrowly tailored it's going to be to, you know, the building code and, you know, and the other restrictions that Mark's talking about. So, you know, I mean, we're talking, you know, we had moved on from this and somehow we got back to it.
So we wanted to take a vote on the consensus.
Yeah.
That's how we got back to it.
Yeah, because we don't want Dan working on the language of a, of another board when the consensus is just keep it Article 78. So that's why I brought it up.
Yep.
Why again can't the planning board be the appeal process for stuff from the new combined landmarks that?
Well, the planning board has a lot of work already dealing with
right.
significant issues.
Well, I don't think this should be monthly. I think you should have a quarterly appeal process to the planning board. It's going to be cumbersome for somebody, regardless. So why can't a planning board on a quarterly basis be also hearing appeals?
Because the informal appeal process, the way it stands now, would be that my office would either go to the council or go to the mayor and say, I can't enforce this. So basically what you're talking about is incorporating that into the code so that the council or the mayor can say, no, you don't have to go to an Article 78. We're going to reverse this at this point because it's indefensible.
I don't think you're going to get, I think everybody who doesn't like the decision is going to go to the Common Council and have a hearing. It's going to be, it's not just going to be a legal question.
It's in the model code now for, you know, for a reason. You know, this wasn't my office's suggestion, this wasn't, you know, Sue's suggestion, it was in the model code. You know, from our perspective as Corporation Council, it would be very helpful to have that process so that we can, you know, put the brakes on in a situation like this.
Dan, what's your...
I don't know that that's the rationale for being in the model code.
What is your recommendation?
That's what I was saying.
I would like there to be a provision that says it could be appealed to the mayor.
To the mayor?
Yeah.
That's my vote. Mayor.
Is there any way to reconcile the building code with the design standards for the historic districts?
Building codes don't deal with design standards.
I'm talking about New York State building code.
Building code has to do with the structure and safety. Mm-hmm. It's got nothing to do with the design standards. Yeah. Design standards are set by us and set in zoning.
Well, something was mentioned before about the fact that someone can do something that's in compliance with the building code, but it violates, for instance, the standards of the Stockade District.
Well, more specifically, it might not violate those. It might simply be, I know there's a specific reference there. Not so much that it violates anything, just that it might not have been what they wanted to see. It's really, what it comes down to is it's almost an opinion thing, whether there's not a of design standards that are already there in the HERC, which I think you referred to a second ago. I'm not sure that you use them. I think the question is whether or not they're being applied equally to everybody. And so there's two things here. One is, can somebody do with the building what they want? The answer is no, but at the same time, yes. Yes, if they're coming to the building department for a building code question, and I say yes, that's fine, and it's done. There's no recourse for me to go back against them, saying no, what you did is absolutely unacceptable, you have to take it out, because I don't have that power. That's where the boards come in. But I think the answer is, are the boards then, in fact, in, across the board, enforcing the code, or the standards that they're set to enforce for each one of the areas, equally with the same, you know, reservation for the code and not for an opinion, you know? Does that make sense?
Can we go around the table?
All right, don't make a motion for the mayor. Make a
we got an article 78
on the mayor. If it's referred to the mayor, do you automatically review it?
The mayor would, you know, the mayor has to our office and say, what is your position?
I would hope that he would do that.
Yeah.
I'm for that suggestion.
I know we're trying to keep the politics out of it, but I mean, if that's the preferred
vehicle, you know,
you're saying okay.
Yeah, but if
all right, then the mayor doesn't really need to appoint a commission. Right. He should just make the decision.
Yeah, he's going to. That was the
recommendation.
I can't believe we're talking about
a surprise.
Hopefully, with the help of Corporation Council.
Well, hopefully, that's the whole purpose of it.
Then,
well, how is an appointed commission? You can sort of given the authority to make these decisions so that one person can overrule it?
At this level, I view it as an opinion. Your opinion was to deny it, and it was referred to the mayor.
Right.
Now you'll get a legal opinion as to whether the comparison to your decision and the code.
Every decision has an appeal process, Ace, no matter what level. By one person. He's the mayor. He's the executive, chief executive.
Is there any other comfortable situation where that kind of a decision is
one
mayor alone?
To be reviewed by one person? That happened with the planning board.
Actually, I believe there are a number of places in the code where the mayor has.
I know there's at least one.
Yep.
I mean, de facto, you've got that now. If you decide and that legally you can't defend it, correct, then it's then the city's not going to defend it, so it's going to happen regardless. But just to say, I mean, here we have a duly appointed commission, but it's certain authorities, but if you don't like it, you can go to one politically elected official and he can decide whether it stands
or not. I could see how that would happen like every single decision, right?
A ton of decisions is going to happen, particularly when people know that's available to them. Can you imagine the political pressure put on one person?
I don't think it's a good idea.
I don't see it as political pressure. I think if you took the time to ask you why you decided how you decided with the board, you guys could say, this is what the design standards are, this is what it's supposed to be, and, you know, making it look like a pink flamingo is not okay. And I don't think there's any pressure there. He's asking you guys, you did what you're supposed to, you defended your decision, and he can ask the other person, why do you want it to be pink?
And hopefully somewhere along the line he gets legal back.
And yeah, Dan will be there the whole time.
Thanks, sir.
Focus.
But you got to think about it, you know, would I trust the current mayor to act in the right way in most of these things? Of course, but you don't know who comes next and who comes next and who comes next.
I understand that. That's why I'm really stuck on the fact that any appeal that goes to the mayor, I would like somehow to be reviewed by corporation.
Before you go there, let's just do you think that there should be some sort of appeal process that can be handled locally versus going on the alternative in Article 78.
Yes.
I could see but we're really getting into the lengthy discussion of how to do it. Let's say if you agree on that you would like a local appeal, but then we can spend some time deciding exactly how that's going to work.
I agree,
we
do need a local appeal process.
I do.
I'm open to
a
local appeal process, but I'm not one person.
Let's make that decision. Then we'll tackle about how to.
But wait a minute. Aren't we talking semantics about one person? Because if we have the commit, we have the board, and he says I can't defend that, then Article 78 is going to be moot because the city's not going to defend it. So one person, in effect, is making the decision anyway. The Corporation Council saying,
I can't defend that commission's or that board's decision. So one person is making it anyway, and by it's going to make the board, is it going to make the landlord?
Well, no, we're making determinations by ourselves.
No, I'm simplifying.
Consultation with our client, which is the council and the mayor.
I'm simplifying it. It's still going to boil down to your recommendation to the mayor on whether or not to pursue it. And it's the same thing. All you're doing is saying, well, the local board here had a decision on it.
No, but we're talking about having that local appeals board thing. That's the get who it is with it, but there's going to be a local appeal where somebody can first go to.
Well, all you're doing is ticking off two boards. You're ticking off the combined heritage area and the landmark because the attorney's saying we can't fight it, and also the board that's making the appeal board that's making the decision, the attorney's saying we can't defend it.
There's no fighting. So if there's a local appeals board, it's the same. It's, when somebody disagrees with the building inspector's decision, they go to that local appeals board. It's, the corporation council's not involved in deciding whether or not you can go to them.
Oh, yes, he is.
Not
directly. Well, Dan, I got a bridge I'm going to sell you. You don't think that we're going to ask corporation council what is our standing if we make this decision? What is the standing if we make this decision?
We're talking about the process before that, which got it to you. Right now, with these decisions that we're talking about, there is no getting it to you. It's going to court.
All it's going to do is tick off two boards. It's going to tick off the appeal board. It's going to tick off the landmark heritage.
Not
if they make
the right decision.
I don't. If the corporation council says we're not going to defend that, you tick two boards off.
But if there's something that you have that you want the school board, or they laid it out for you, that helps you make a decision. Because if that's the case, then you've made a defendable decision. But if it's the kind of thing where you're looking at something, and then you're looking at something else, and it's not really what you want to see, and that's what you base your decision on, then you know that's an indefensible decision, and that's what, and this comes down to. If the decision you guys are making is one that stands up, if there's a reason you made it, and it's measurable and repeatable, or whatever you want to call it, then there's no reason that the mayor wouldn't just say, yeah, I like it too, he could do it. You would have to say, no, I'm going to have to stand by board. They used, you know, this is how they came to the decision, this is what they looked at, this is the decision.
And that is what we would be looking to this new law to help us provide.
Exactly.
Right now we have contradictory requirements that are really tough to enforce because they are inconsistent in our present law. And we are left trying to reconcile the irreconcilable. I believe that part of what's going on here is that it will be made more solid and reconcilable and easier to link to just one set of standards rather than, especially in the stockade district, we have with what Hayes has to do as well, two or three that are not headed in the same direction often. And so I am hopeful that what is happening here in the code revision will make the decisions that certainly my board or this combined board makes more readily defensible than they are right now in some cases,
right?
Because we're left staring at stuff going, well, this would push us this way, that would push us that way, let's try that. And it's not a comfortable place for us. I know it's an uncomfortable place for Dan and the corporation councils before him.
So what do you want to do?
You tell me. Do you want?
I would like to just put in a plug for trusting this board that you're constituting, that you'll give us the kinds of guidelines / standards that we need to make this as consistent as possible. Yeah, you're right. There will be someone who sees a different shade of red. Mm-hmm. But we have palettes we hold up and can say, choose from one of these.
The only appeal from that decision would be in Article 78. You want to have some sort of an alternative local
I would ask that it be the article instead of the VA.
I think the other thing you have to recognize with regard to what Mark is saying is, and again, it takes us back to where we started. If you create one board with nine members and there are three alternates, we are going to have quorums ruling on all of these applications where there will be split votes and there will be actual discussion. The way it works now is because we have such trouble getting quorums, almost every decision has to be unanimous, okay? And you know, once you fill out the slate, and once you have a board that is functioning where there's actual deliberation at the table, and you have, you know, discussion and votes, sometimes it'll be 5-4, you know, sometimes it'll be 6-3, but you won't need, you know, 5 out of 5 because you don't have people sitting there. You know, so again, you have to, you know, first decide whether you're going to combine the commissions, how many people are going to be on the commissions, whether you're going to have alternates. You have to put in place a process for removing members who don't show up. These are the issues you need to be focusing on. The rest of these things are so far down the priority list.
I think we're very excited on some, right?
Well, you haven't really decided on a lot of them.
Well, the ones you just mentioned, we have nine members and three.
You haven't discussed, you know, alternates, which was a critical component of alternates. That wasn't discussed tonight, but certainly not on the.
It was discussed at an earlier meeting. I remember the number as well as usual.
You have to have provisions for removal of members, which you currently don't have. Which we go through on a regular basis, where if people just don't show up and there's no process to remove them and they refuse to resign.
That's why Wayne talked about having the education requirements.
And you have to address the education requirements and the other, you know, powers of the board. You have to start talking about what Mark is speaking about in terms of the design requirements and clarifying what these boards are supposed to do before you can make an intelligent decision as to whether or not and how the appeal process is going to run.
The first process, the part of the process, was to say, what are the responsibilities and duties of this board, right, which is what we've been talking about. Doesn't purport to be a full piece of legislation, but you have, how long have we taken to debate on one particular point?
That's a pretty essential point.
It is. Absolutely, I agree. But that's why we don't, you know, we haven't spent a lot of time on some of these other things, which hopefully will be
Can we agree to have an appeals process? We haven't determined it yet.
We'll have to take a vote because there's two that aren't in favor that I can see right now. And there's three that are. Who else needs to vote that hasn't voted?
I'm not saying what the appeals process should be. I mean, I just think we should have that appeals process.
I think it should be a local appeals.
That's what I'm saying, a local appeals.
We'll agree on what it is.
Agree on that and move on to the next, you know, we'll determine, we'll think about it.
I'm not sure who's saying three
of us are in favor of appeals. Hayes and Mark are, leave it as it is, Article 78 and Lee.
I'd be in favor of a local appeals.
Me too.
I would leave it as the Article 78.
Okay, so three Article 78s, four appeals.
Appeals.
Okay, so then it's 5-3.
But local appeals?
Local appeals.
So, Dan, what we'll do is we'll sit down and try and figure out the structure for that. Maybe we can come up with a couple of scenarios to circulate.
For your purpose, to work on something.
All right, moving right along. Why don't we leave item 3 for the time being? Way back when we talked about having a zoning handbook or primer or something that explains how zoning works and how the zoning elements of the new zoning law. Jim's been asking me for how many years?
Many.
Yeah, so I think what I'm suggesting, we maybe change the format of a little bit as opposed to just explaining hazy. So many people may not have been around when we talked about it years ago. It's basically to have a layman's explanation and we talked about something which basically would go through each zoning district and have a page on it where its purpose is, illustrations of how the standards work and so forth. I think since, you know, we're not every change that's required that to really make this a first-class zoning law is going to make this part of this round, I thought we might just change the focus of this a little bit by doing some portion of this be more of a bit of a primer on why do we have zoning, how does it work, what happens if you're not happy with it, who administers it, supplemented by something with design and graphics on how some of the design standards work, how setback standards, whether the elements of designing work. So it's something relatively brief with pictures and simple diagrams that people can understand. That can be handed out to people who are never going to pick up the zoning law, and if they did, would never get very far in it.
But it could at least direct them, here's the one part to the zoning law you got to go to. Yeah.
What I was going to suggest is that we work with Sue to put together, we put together an application to the Greenway Commission to get some funds to be able to do that. We talked to them back when we were talking before, and they seemed to think it was a pretty good idea. But if you agree, we would put something together with Sue and have it ready to go get approved by the council.
Good.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Could you just briefly, what do we have left to do? Maybe not so
brief. Is there other appeals process?
Because I thought we were done with one section and we spent everything we could do.
We got two or three sections that we haven't.
Like what?
Urban agriculture. We got to finish up the stuff that we're still evolving. It's environmental and natural resource regulations. And some proposals for the Uptown Core. And we got we've got all of these other pieces, which
at least six or seven more meetings at least.
You're an optimist.
Maybe he's worse.
Then you have to have public hearing. Then you have to before we close up, can we, because I know we're running a little later than our schedule had planned. We want to set the next meeting, and one of the ideas that Jim and Dan and I had spoken about would be to set a meeting up that would allow for interest groups to come and speak on potential zoning changes they would like to see. They would be allotted a certain amount of time. I was thinking 10 minutes apiece. Yeah. They would have to obviously contact our office. We would get them signed up in advance. And then, so we would have one meeting, and then that would give them an opportunity to just present to or speak to an issue that, you know, they're passionate about. Does that make sense to everybody? We're looking in May for that meeting.
May.
Probably. Today, the fourth Wednesday.
Third is a Wednesday.
The third Wednesday.
No, the 17th.
The fourth Wednesday of the month. I'm sorry.
The 24th.
I just think that seems to be a day where there's no meeting in this room that typically takes place.
24th?
So are you talking about the 24th or the 17th?
Isn't the 4th Wednesday there?
Right, no.
Oh, you said the 3rd Wednesday?
Yeah, whatever. What's the tree commission? We meet the 3rd.
So it's the 24th.
24th
is what it was.
That's the 4th Wednesday.
Yeah, what's the 3rd?
17th.
The 17th. How about 17th?
I'm not sure I can make that here.
No? Okay.
There is a commission meeting on the 24th?
We have Heritage Commission tonight.
Heritage Commission.
Oh, we know where your allegiance is lying.
That's the last time we met on the 4th, please.
That works through the 25th.
I can look, I can do a doodle poll. I'll come up.
That's a nifty little.
Do you like my doodles?
Just as a follow-up question.
I don't think either one of them worked.
Yeah, the 17th said it sounded like it worked. The 24th doesn't work, so it might be.
There's 5 Wednesdays in May. There you go, a 5th one.
I guess a question for Dan and for Jim. So after you mentioned the 3 additional areas, we're going to, my impression is then not a full zoning law revision is going to be presented to the Common Council, because there will be areas that we haven't discussed within the zoning law.
Absolutely. We said
so. The Common Council will be getting a partial revision.
Yeah.
And that's going to be okay?
Going to have to be.
Okay. So we're going to have really 2 separate. We're still going to be using 1963 language in some areas, and 2017 in other zoning areas. Okay.
So what's the date?
So she's going to send.
I'm going to send out my famous doodle poll.
And it's going to have some 1963 lingo on it.
Yes. I'll do this.
Oh, no, no. It's all through.
Dan, whatever happened to the Broadway corridor? I mean, I thought that would be fairly simple to extend the boundaries. Did you ever look at
that? Oh, we did.
Okay.
That's, yeah, we, I mean, I think that everybody agreed on the basic ground rules of the regulation. It's a matter of the delineation of boundaries. We'll bring back the map and we'll get that out.
Okay.
I know Chappelle has said fine on the merger. Can we ever just cross our eyes or cross our T's with Department of State to basically
support it?
So I'm going to go out on a real big limb on this one. Are there, just as a consideration, is there anything that could be brought to the comp that has some urgency to it that we've discussed over the past year and a half, whatever? Any urgency that could be brought to the Common Council as a piecemeal?
Well, we talked about that, remember, I brought up the subject 3 or 4 months ago, as I recall, and the consensus was, let's do it all at once, as I recall.
Okay. Now, I just wondered if there was anything council saw or whatever that really needed some urgency to it.
You told me, I'm not sure.
I don't want to jump on your hands.
Yeah, I think the section on zoning should, a message should go to Laws and Rules for them to act on. The Zoning Board of Appeals practice not having enough members, so forth, they need to be addressed quantitatively.
So you're saying there should be something for all the boards, pretty much?
No.
They had that issue on the other ones.
Well, Bernie raised a good point that the ZBA is operating under 1963 legislation. We prepared a complete rewrite of that section, which complies with the state law, and it's really a standalone amendment.
Okay.
You don't have to tie it to anything else.
Mm-hmm. So we'll send it to me.
I would love it if there was some provision for using board members who don't show up.
Removing, not losing.
The zoning board of appeals, if you miss more than 20 meetings, you can be...
Well, Mark is talking about
HLTC, where I served for a long time, it has been a recurring issue for the better part of...
Right, that was something that we did discuss tonight.
Yes, it would...
That definitely has to be brought in. Not only that, the attendance...